So that's same topic, and we are gonna study the social security contribution and the reforms that affected them a bit in more detail at what Eric presented. On the other hand, we won't study differences by occupation, so the occupational dimensions and the type of jobs that have developed or decreased. This is something we don't do, so I think it's gonna complete. But that's a similar type of question we ask. So, I mean, to give a motivation and a starting point, if you look at something you probably know, at the evolution of wage inequality in developed countries over the past 30 years, say, you see that it's increasing in most of them. And if you take France as a comparison, it's decreasing, something that Eric already mentioned. So this is the statistics. Here is the ratio of the wage at the ninth decile of the wage distribution to the wage at the first decile. So that's typical statistics labor economists use to measure sorry, wage inequality. And what's quite striking, and you can see that France was almost at the level of the US in the mid-70s, while the US had an increase of about 40% in their wage inequality, France had at the same time a decrease of about 15%. So this is log point, so you can interpret the variation as in a first order as percentages, okay? So we started from being among the most inegalitarian countries in terms of wage inequality, and we moved to something much more egalitarian. So the paper is basically about explaining how this could have happened. Well, I'm going to be fast on the typical explanation, as Eric already introduced them. So there is first all that is can be due to technological change, so skill-based technological change. So this is the progrès technique biaisé. I'm speaking about the same thing. And then job polarization that emerged a bit later in the 2000s and that is said to have concerned mostly the 1990s. And that induced the polarization between high-skilled jobs and low-skilled jobs with a decrease of the jobs in the middle. The idea being that the type of occupations that can be replaced easily by robots, by automation, are the jobs in the middle. For example, if you take personal services, cleaning activities, those are low-skilled jobs that are hard to replace by machines, or that were still hard to replace by machine at the time of the studies. Now maybe we start to do it, but at that time it was hard to replace by machines. And on the other hand, jobs at the very top of the wage distribution, the most skilled, either executive jobs, management positions, or intellectual professions, are also hard to replace by machines. Whereas you have in the middle some manual jobs that require a lot of precision, for example, crafts, this type of jobs, and those can be replaced by machines that are also very precise and that can do this type of jobs better than humans. So that's the general I mean, context. And then there is also globalization that puts competition on low wage earners and that can induce an increase in inequality. And in front of this big, I'm brushing the picture of the explanation very, very quickly here. But in front of those changes that concern more the demand side, the demand for different type of workers, people put institutional factors that can mitigate the increase in inequality, the minimum wage, the role of unions, or possibly educational policies as well that gonna affect the supply of different types of workers and which can reduce inequality. So there is this general framework of opposing institutions to explanations that are more related to structural change. And so the consensus as we understand it is that there is strong support for skill-based technical change. Polarization is more debated. I mean, even for the US, you have papers now telling you that everything that has been found is due to a problem in coding occupation and changing in the way occupation were coded over time. I mean, but so far, the consensus is that we had skill-based technical change and there is also evidence of polarization, limited impact of minimum wage in the US, etc. And in this context that I give very quickly, France appears somehow puzzling because, again, that's one of the only developed countries where wage inequality have been decreasing. And the previous paper find mixed evidence regarding technology. So Eric, Dominique have a former paper looking at the early age of skill-based technical change, the 80s, early 90s, where they find no evidence of it. And then some papers find some evidence, but at least it's more controversial than in Anglo-Saxon countries, I would say. And you can say, well, it's about the French institution, like the minimum wage has compressed inequality so much in France. That's why we see this compression in inequality, and it interfere with the standard ways we have to measure skill-based technical change, so we cannot see it. But this argument may prevail for the bottom part of the wage distribution, okay, the low-paid people. But if you look at the top, you also see in France this compression in wage inequality that cannot be attributed to the minimum wage. And that goes against the idea of skill-based technical change, especially because some have argued that this skill-based technical change should be especially strong at the top for very high-skilled occupations. And highly educated people, so it's not very easy to explain what happens in France. So what we do, as you may have guessed, we are gonna propose an explanation that relies on differences between net wages or gross wages, called here posted wages, and labor costs. So we do what Eric also did, but on a longer period with different data. And I'm gonna tell you more in detail about what has changed in terms of the difference in France between the labor cost, which is what an employer, a firm pays to a given worker, and the net wage that the workers receive on their pay slip. And we'll see that when it comes to the labor cost, the basic fact is actually different. We have an increase in labor cost inequality instead of a decrease. And then we revisit those standard determinants related to technological change using also the cost, as Eric and Dominique do it, because that's how it should be done, right? Because the demand for workers that depends on the technology that firms use is something that depends obviously of the labor cost and not of the wage. That's entirely obvious. That's a very obvious observation, but nevertheless, most papers ignore that completely. So they take the wage as the measure of what should be the cost for firms of hiring skilled or unskilled workers. I'm going to talk about the minimum wage quickly, maybe very quickly, because as I'm supposed to speak about digital transformation, I think I should speak more about skill-based technical change. And then I'll turn to the impact of payroll taxes on inequality, which is our main question, actually, in this paper. We are going to ask if we had in France a reduction in wage inequality that can be attributed to changes in payroll taxes. And that can depend on the incidence of taxes in the long run, have then been paid by employers or by workers. Okay, so I'm going to describe the data. The Social Security Contribution, so SSC stands for Social Security Contribution, or payroll taxes in the US terminology, changes over the period, and then descriptive results on wage inequality, and then I'll turn to these later parts on the mechanisms, basically, behind changes in inequality. Okay, so we use the French Social Security records, called the DADS. Those are administrative data. We have one twenty-fourth of the population before 1993, and then 1/12 afterwards. We observe in the data annual net earnings, and we also, after 1993, observe the hours worked. And we match this to get information on education with the EDP, which is built from national censuses, and that's how we get educational attainment, but for a smaller fraction of the sample. So for the wage statistics I'm going to show you, these are based on 1/12 or 1/24 of the working population, so that's fairly large for France. Here it's a bit less than 1%, and so the series starts to be a bit blurry. So to make very sure that you follow me, those are, in a simplified manner, what are the different concepts I'm going to use. So the net wage is the what we can be called disposable labor income, or we call it net of income tax wage, plus the income tax. This is what we observe in the data. Then you can add employee social security contribution that I paid by the employee, that we calculate using a tax simulator that is built at the Institute of Public Policy. And then to that, we also add the employer social security contribution that we also calculate using the tax simulator at the IPP. And so we have the net wage, gross wage, and labor cost. Okay, so here is the first thing I wanted to show you. That's the weight of the different of the social security contribution, both the employer part and the employee part, for different decides of the wage distribution, okay, and how it evolves over time. So I'm gonna start with the first decide, okay, the low paid people. So in the first decile, if you start in 67, you see that they were paying about 28% of their total cost. I mean, the total cost of hiring a low-paid worker was going into social security contribution. And this has increased again and again to reach about 40, between 40 and 45%. So meaning that when the employer pays 100, the worker gets 55, okay? After paying all the contributions. And then you started to have those policies of reduction of social security contribution for low-wage earners, and it started decreasing again, quite substantially, okay, getting back to a level which is a bit below 30%. Okay. And then if you look at the top, something quite different happened. The top decile experienced very, very low average rate of contribution in the 60s, 70s. Because historically, when the social security was built in France, the contributions were capped. So there is a threshold, and above the threshold, workers were not paying, okay? With the idea that the needs for social security are increasing up to some point, but after a given cap, you know, I mean, you're not, you don't need to contribute more to the unemployment insurance because with the unemployment insurance we give to you, you've paid enough for this. Okay, so these contributions were actually very regressive. The top earners were paying very few, and they were uncapped, meaning that the top of the wage distribution experienced a huge increase in the weight of this contribution. Okay, sorry.
Well, you could hear me, no? No, you couldn't. That's for that. Okay, so a huge increase from 15% to about 45%. And in the middle, that's the green line, you see that there is a steady, slow increase, which is due to the fact that to maintain for the Social Security not to go bankrupt, we had to increase the rate of contribution for everybody steadily over the period. And they are at the level of the top, about the top right now. Okay, so that's stay here. That's the basic fact. Maybe I can show you that as well briefly. So that's another way of showing exactly the same thing. So that's pure computation based on the rule of calculation of the social security contribution. Instead of showing you the evolution over time for different deciles of the wage distribution, I'm showing you the full schedule, meaning the full average rate of contribution per decile and for different periods of time. Okay, so the purple line is in 1967, and you see how regressive were the contributions at that time. There was a flat rate up to about the seventh decile of the wage distribution, and then you start to see a decrease, and the people at the top, here we zoom on the very top of the distribution, they were paying almost zero, okay, no contribution at all. And you have first this uncapping of the contribution, meaning that you have an increase and the top starts to pay more. And then you also see appearing at the bottom in the 2000s and in 2015, those large reduction of contribution. You can note, interestingly, that there still remain a regressive schedule at the very top, even now, okay? So there is still a cap. It's very high up in the distribution. The cap used to be at the seventh decile. Now the cap has been moved above the top 1%, okay, but there is still a cap so that the very high wage earners today pay less contribution as a fraction of their wage than the other people. Okay, so now that's wage inequality. So that's first net wage and gross wage inequality we compute from the admin data. So we find back what other people have found. There is a reduction in those inequalities. And there is a very spectacular reduction in the late 60s and 70s. And then it's more stable, but there is still a small reduction. Okay? And then comes what you see if you look at the labor cost inequality. Okay, so same thing measured in terms of the labor cost. Okay, so we just add the social security contribution. So there are three periods to be distinguished. The first is this period that happens before any reform took place for social security contribution, before the uncapping. So you have a parallel reduction in all types of inequality. It's all decreasing. And then you start having this divergence where labor cost inequality increases in the early 80s while you still have a slight decrease in net or gross wage inequality. Okay? And so the divergence between the different inequality concepts is entirely explained by the reforms of social security contribution. First, the uncapping for high wage earners and then the reduction in the bottom. Okay, so that's basically the first part of the paper, and you can see that similar things that can be observed in the top of the distribution. Here is the top of the distribution, so that's P90 over P50. We only look at the divergence between top wage earners and middle wage earners. Okay, here you see that the convergence between the curves happens in the early period. This is because the uncapping happens at that time. And then you have a more parallel trend between the different types of inequality because there is no more reform that can explain a divergence. And if you look at the bottom, that's the opposite. At the bottom, the wage inequality measured either in terms of labor cost, gross wage, or net wage are completely similar. Okay? There is no difference at all in these inequality. This is because between the P50 and the P10, this is exactly, those people are paying exactly the same rate of contribution. Okay? And then starts in the early 90s, the reduction in social contribution for low wage earners. And that's how you see that there is a jump in labor cost inequality and a decrease in net or gross wage inequality. Maybe a last comment on this general graph, which is that when you see that labor cost inequality are lower than the net wage inequality at a given point, this is because the tax schedule is regressive for social security contribution. And the point where the tax schedule starts being not regressive is exactly this middle point in the early 90s where we start to do the reduction in the bottom part of the wage distribution. At that point, you have more inequality in terms of labor cost than in terms of net or gross wage, meaning that we start doing actual redistribution with social security contribution. Okay, so if you take labor cost inequality, France looks the change over the period we look at is similar to what is observed in other countries. Okay, we are no more an outlier as we are if we look only at the net wage inequality. So that put back France as a country that has similar trends, global trends than other countries. Okay, so that's now what we do. I mean, I'm very sorry, what we do in terms of studying digital transformations in the paper is very limited because that's not the main goal, but I'm gonna tell you nevertheless. We study the old-fashioned way first, which consists of that Katz-Murphy approach, the seminal paper in 1993, which consists in saying, well, this is the supply of educated versus non-educated workers, so people with diplomas or no diplomas, and this is the demand for them. And what has happened over time, which is well known and that is supposed to be exogenous from the labor market point of view, is that there is an increase in the supply of skilled workers, people with diplomas. Okay? And well, when you have an increase in supply, if there is no change in the demand for skilled workers, you should see that the price of skilled workers decreases, the relative price as compared to the unskilled. But what we have actually seen is that the relative price of skilled workers versus non-skilled workers has not decreased, but it has increased. Okay? So from this, we infer, we don't observe anything on the demand, on the technology of firms, it's not entirely unobserved, But we assume there must have been a demon shift at the same time. That's how the basic approach proceeds to say there was a demand shift towards skilled workers with respect to unskilled workers. And so this is what we find for France for the period. So the dotted line curve, this curve, is the evolution of the relative supply of people with a baccalaureate or more versus less than a baccalaureate, okay? And so you see it's increasing over the period. I told you the series are more blurry because we have less data to compute those series based on education. So it's a bit ugly, but that's the data we have. And then if you look at the wage premium for having a diploma, you can measure it either in terms of net wage or labor cost. You see that despite the increase in the supply of skilled workers, there was an increase in the wage premium of labor cost. So that's the evidence of skill bias technical change. And if you look at the labor cost instead of the net wage, you see that the increase in the labor cost over the period of the premium for being educated in terms of the labor cost is higher, which implies that we are going to say there is more demand shift if we use the labor cost. So you can do that with very basic, simple regression, which consists in regressing the wage gap between skilled and unskilled workers with simple controls for the relative supply. So the relative supply captures, if you have a CS production function, to what extent having more skilled workers should decrease their wage premium. And then you put a time trend, and the time trend measures the demand shift over time. So we do this very simple exercise. We don't invent anything. And the main point is that if you use the labor cost, you find more demand shift towards skilled workers than if you use only net wage. Okay. Let me move to the second exercise we do to study digital transformation, broadly speaking, which is slightly more interesting, even if it's also just a reproduction of another replication for France of another paper by Michael, Snatrash, and Van Rienen. What we do is we've matched our data to EU claims data. Okay. EU claims data is sectoral data for a bunch of countries, where you can observe the labor cost by different education groups. And what we've done, we've linked changes in ICT, the investment in the share of ICT capital in the value added, okay? How this has changed over the period 78-2015, to the change of the wage bill share of high-skilled workers or other types of workers. And what these graphs show you, it's quite blurry, is that so that sectors, each dot is a sector, that sectors that experience the largest changes in the investment on ICT in ICT capital are also the sector where the wage bill share of the skilled workers increase the most. Okay, and then if you take instead of the high skilled workers, you take the middle skilled workers, people in the middle. So that's not, again, occupations or jobs. That's just we define people according to their diplomas and education. If you take people in the middle, you see the opposite. You see that when you have a high change in ICT technology in a given sector, this sector, on average, has decreased the wage bill share of people with intermediate educational levels. And in the bottom, you also see a decrease, but the decrease in the bottom is smaller than the one in the middle. So this is evidence of polarization. We can discuss, but that's what we do. And we do that using the labor cost, of course, because we argue that's what should be done. Let me show you maybe two things in the time I still have, like 3 minutes, maybe 3 minutes, four, two, four. Oh, thank you. So the minimum wage. This paper is very descriptive, so we don't do anything very fancy, but if you look at the minimum wage, this is how it has increased over the period we study. You see huge, so it's normalized to 100 in terms of all wage concept in 1993. You see a huge increase around 1968 with the May Revolution in France. Okay, so huge increase in 68, 69. And then still a very large increase in the 70s, which started to stagnate more in the mid 80s with a decade here of stagnation in real terms of the minimum wage. And here comes the reduction in social security contribution, which implies that in terms of net or gross wage, you still have an increase in the minimum wage, but it decreases in terms of labor cost. Okay. And so we argue that there is a huge effect of the minimum wage on the wage inequality in the bottom. To show this, what we do is that we remove the trends in the wage inequality, because we argue that we don't want to compare just pure trends, positive trends in wage inequality or in the minimum wage and in negative trend in wage inequality. So we remove the trends and we try to study if in periods where you have a larger increase or an acceleration in the increase of the minimum wage as compared to the trend, if those periods are also periods where you have a larger decrease in wage inequality as compared to the trend. And we see that the relationship is very strong. It can be partly spurious, so we compute correlation, etc. But we don't find something similar if we look at the upper tail wage inequality. So we really see that in the bottom, in that period where you have a huge increase in the minimum wage as compared to the trend, a strong increase. You have a strong decrease in net wage inequality as compared to the trend. I mean, you have other evidence. I'm not going to tell you much more. I'm going to skip a large part on the last part of the paper that is asking the question, I mean, what would have been the prevailing wage distribution in the absence of any tax change, you know, which comes to the question of incident. Who eventually has paid the tax changes that we, the social security contribution changes that we document? So, would we have seen in France that all type of inequalities would have decreased, okay? Or would we have seen that from the 80s, net wage inequalities would have increased like labor cost inequality? We would have parallel trends between the labor cost and net wage inequality, but what would have been the scenario? So one basic argument is that as wage inequality increased in all countries, probably a good counterfactual is this scenario where we would have seen more net wage inequality in France, just as we observe for labor cost, in the absence of any tax reform. Okay, telling you that we have managed in France to reduce inequality with the tax reform. So this is a bit crude, and we elaborate on that in the paper. But I won't do that. I'm just gonna maybe show you this and conclude in 30 seconds. This is a comparison of the income tax schedule and the social security contribution tax schedule applied to wage earners with some assumption that we had underlying this comparison. But you can see that for the income tax schedule, so that's the evolution over time, I hope you can see. There is less and less income tax over time in France. You can see that what remains concerns the very top, and if you take 90% of the wage earners, they pay limited income tax, so that much of the redistribution, we argue, for 90% of wage earners in France is actually done through the social security contribution. Maybe last point is on the political economy aspect of this. This redistribution, if you want to assume this is redistribution, got very unnoticed. Okay, there is huge scrutiny on the income tax. This is the normal redistributive tool. Everybody focuses on this. The IPP analyzes the budget, etc., the income tax reforms, etc. I mean, people do that all the time. So there is huge political scrutiny on this. And this is not the case for what we document here. And employer social security contribution reduction are even seen by unions as gift to employers, because they are nominally paid by employers. This is something that is considered as a gift to employers, whereas we take a different view here and we say it can be used to redistribute. Okay, I'm done.
Time for questions.
Peut-être pour prolonger un peu ce qui était la conclusion du précédent papier, est-ce que vous connaissez, si vous savez si dans les autres pays développés, il y a eu des politiques similaires en termes de taxation pour les bas salaires, s'il y a des réductions des côtés taxes ou sécurité sociale?
Ouais, il y en a. Alors je ne vais pas pouvoir te documenter en détail. Il y a deux types, il y a deux grands modèles. Il y a le modèle qui fait de l'income tax credit, la prime pour l'emploi. Modèle anglo-saxon, je vais le faire très simplifié. Pas de salaire minimum ou un salaire minimum bas, qui ne fait pas contrainte comme en France, et où on va jouer du coup sur, sur l'offre de travail en incitant à aller travailler pour des salaires très bas, en donnant de la prime pour l'emploi. Okay, c'est income tax credit. Donc les US se sont mis à faire ça, beaucoup, et le Royaume-Uni fait ça aussi. Donc ça, c'est les dispositifs anglo-saxons qui existent dans un monde sans salaire minimum. Et il y a le pendant d'un monde avec salaire minimum, c'est-à-dire on a un salaire minimum élevé qui garantit un salaire net important, et on va faire en parallèle de la réduction du coût du travail en jouant plutôt sur des subsides ou des baisses de cotisations, mais pour les employeurs. Et ça, c'est fait, je crois, aux Pays-Bas et dans d'autres pays d'Europe. On avait le projet de regarder, mais comme on a mis très longtemps déjà à finir ça, on ne l'a pas encore fait. Mais ouais, il faudrait regarder.
Sur la période récente, le CICE, vous le prenez, comment vous le prenez en compte?
Alors le CICE, si, il est où? Il y est, il faut que je te retrouve le bon, attends, j'ai regardé là. Ouais, c'est où le meilleur moment pour le voir, le CICE. je pense que c'est ce petit pic, tu vois là, le D5. D5, c'est très haut, et un petit pic blurp dans le D5. Attends, est-ce que c'est le CICE, ça? Oui, je crois que c'est le CICE. Voilà, je pense que là, on le voit. On voit un truc qui touche le bas, là, clac, clac, et là, et puis après, on ne le voit plus. Voilà. On voit le CICE qui va assez haut. Qui est assez petit quand même finalement par rapport à tout ce qui s'est déjà passé.
Dans le haut, c'est le déplafonnement.
Ouais, ça c'est le phénomène assez peu documenté qui en fait joue un rôle assez important.